afternoon. 6 years ago, as was mentioned by Dr. Lianto, BOST actually engaged in a partnership with the then NSO and PIDS in the conduct and analysis of a pilot survey of innovation activities involving about 500 firms. And it's my pleasure to present this afternoon on behalf of a PIDS team comprising myself, Dr. Francis Kimba, one of our junior fellows who's just finished last year, no? from GRIPS, Dr. Ramonette Serafica, who tends to work more in the services sector, PIDS President Gilbert Yanto, and some of our RAs, Jana Flor Bismanas and JC Bayran. Some of the main results of this 2015 survey of on innovation activities conducted by PIDS. This survey was actually first conceived 3 years ago. Imagine it takes a while when you conceive it, planning processes. No? It was suggested by our PIDS board, led by then NEDA Director General R.C. Balisakan, because they wanted PIDS to conduct a survey to benchmark where the country stands as regards innovation. Although we already did work previously in 2009-2010 with BOST and the then NSO. Anyways, how do I use this? I go to the next slide or use some which is controlling?
No, sir.
I can use this up and down.
Yes.
So this one is up or down?
Down.
How is this? Which is up and which is down? I'm not innovating. Okay. Okay. I know that. Thank you. Okay. So allow me to frame my discussions firstly on why monitoring innovation is important before proceeding to giving the main results of this 2015 survey on innovation activities, and then ending with some policy issues and ways forward. And as mentioned by Dr. Yanto, while the term innovation means different things to different people, we typically adopt a when measuring innovation, a broad Schumpeterian view of innovation as the ability to use knowledge to develop and apply new ideas that result in changes in the production and organizational structure of the firm. So this typically, sometimes when people think of that innovation, then they would think of equating innovation purely with R&D, specifically invention, but it's much more than invention, right? Innovation includes commercial applications of new knowledge, new materials, new processes, new methods, and it primarily involves the adoption of existing technologies also in new ways, the process of copying or imitating attributes from other products, or the adoption of new managerial and organizational practices or business models from other companies. So we don't need to have the innovation purely on a technical innovation. It could also be non-technical or, as I mentioned, managerial or organizational innovation. Innovation will include the invention of new technologies, but it also and disruptive business models, and as I mentioned, there, you might also have wider forms of innovation. But innovation is widely regarded by many as a major driver of economic output, productivity, and competitiveness. And in consequence, last September 2015, 194 countries, including the Philippines, committed to fostering innovation by 2030. Among other sustainable development goals, particularly in what's known as SDG number 9 on industry, infrastructure, and innovation. And the Philippine government even laid out in its recent 2017 to 2022 Philippine Development Plan an entire chapter that identifies a goal to vigorously advance science, technology, and innovation. In this chapter, in this PDP chapter, as was pointed out by Dr. Yanto earlier, the country has not actually scored very well in the Global Innovation Index. Now, this is a composite index released by Cornell, among other organizations, that's based on data derived from several sources, including the International Telecommunications Union, the World Bank, and the World Economic Forum. And it's anchored in two sub-indices, an innovation input sub-index and an innovation output sub-index that are respectively rooted in five and two pillars, respective two pillars. The first sub-index as institutions, human capital, research, infrastructure, market sophistication, and business sophistication, while the second sub-index has knowledge and technology outputs as well as creative outputs as part of this sub-index. Our recent data shows that we rank not very well. Fifth among seven member states of ASEAN, and 73rd among 127 economies, as stated by Dr. Yanto. But being 73 is not really very different from the previous ranking of 74, no? The year before. Unlike Vietnam, if you look at Vietnam, it was already doing better, 59 in 2016, and then it made a jump of 12 ranks. Now that's also one of the reasons why I think now many foreign investors are starting to jump ship towards that part of the region. And it has outpaced even Thailand, which used to be number 3. Now it's number 3. So Vietnam is the country to watch. And I'm seeing a lot of other indicators that suggest really that Vietnam is a lot in, is well, maybe we'll talk about Vietnam in some ways later. But anyway, the PDP attributes this poor performance of the country in the GII to the low amount of public expenditures on research and development. Look at how much we're spending. Less, practically 0.14% of GDP. Whereas other countries like Singapore are spending more beyond 2% of their GDP. By the way, as far as R&D spending is concerned, of course, you can say, oh, there was an increase, no? 0.12 to 0.14. Okay. But still, this spending is less than one-fifth of 1%. And UNESCO suggests that developing countries should be spending 1% of GDP. So we're below Singapore and Malaysia, and even Thailand and Vietnam, no? And the relatively low spending on R&D has been noted even more than a decade ago by doing several of our studies here at PIDS. It somehow reflects the low priority provided to science, technology, and innovation. A second indicator, no? If you look at the number of research scientists that we have per million people, I think, if I recall right, per million people. So we have, of latest, 189 per million Filipinos. Now, we look at Singapore. Of course, they're a barangay only, no? But then, a barangay by our standards. But then, you look at the figures, no? Really way ahead of us. So, anyways, we again the supposed benchmark for UNESCO should be 380 RSEs, research scientists and engineers per million people. So 380. So we're still less than half of the benchmark. Okay. So, anyways, when we look at all of these trends across our neighbors, we might notice that these neighbors are also, by the way, ahead of us in competitiveness indices, business indices, and also in crafting innovation, competition policy. They rank much better than us. And of course, you might say, well, we already have a competition, though. Yeah, but recent, compared with those other countries that crafted these laws way ahead of us. So anyways, the whole point when you're looking at these storylines is that this gives us really a reason for us to measure innovation in order to gain insight on what exactly is going on in the innovation ecosystem in the country. No? So we want to determine what needs to be done to foster innovation. So that's why our survey on innovation activities was exactly that, trying to give a benchmark of national performance in innovation to describe also the determinants, barriers, and bottlenecks to innovation. And because, you know, being researchers, we also wanted to think, oh, wait a minute, let's try to find out, can we because we already had the pilot with NSO, the then NSO, about 500 firms. Can we also try to survey the same firms as part of our survey? So we that's why this recent survey, we were targeting, actually originally we were targeting 10,000 firms to be surveyed, but unfortunately there were procurement processes that led us to drop the number to 1,000. Don't ask me, this is a procurement issue in government, but ironically, by the time that we started our negotiations with the PSA, we were told, oh, you can already proceed, but it was already fait accompli. No? So anyways, so we were stuck with the 1,000 samples, but we tried our best to originally, as per design, we were really trying to get as many of the firms that were also surveyed in the pilot 2009 survey. We designed the survey carefully so that we would mirror about 30,000 firms across four major industry groups, food manufacturing, other manufacturing, ICT, and BPOs. Because originally that was those were more or less the same groups that we were surveying in a very small scale, only because we were only focusing on four areas, if I recall right, four very small areas. But now we expanded it to be more nationally representative, but only for these major areas, major industry groups. So this distribution from the sample and the establishments would show us more or less why we managed to make this fairly representative. Now, as in other establishment surveys, targeted respondents for the survey and innovation activities are owners and managers of the sampled firms. The reference period was the calendar year 2015, although for employment, we made a cutoff of 15th November. The survey was also to be self-administered by the responding establishments, and as you might mention by Dr. Yanto, the Philippine Statistics Authority assisted us in the conduct of the survey. Now in the next set of slides, allow me to first, before going to the details of the results, just give you some general information about these establishments. By legal organization, about two-thirds of the firm are stock corporations, and 30% are single proprietorships, whatever that means. By economic organization, about 60% are single establishments. 70% of the firms were established during the past 20 years, about half of which were established in the last 10 years. So fairly not too old, not too young. But most of the micro-sized firms were established in the past decade, while the many small, medium, and large firms were established after the last 10, but before the last 20 years. The biggest concentration of capital of or equity of firms is from local investors. Firms in Luzon, outside of NCR, have the least average share of capital participation across establishments. With local investors having about 85% of the share of the capital, the Japanese having the biggest share of non-local investors at 7.5%. Next to Balance Luzon, Metro Manila has the least share of local investors at 87%. In the NCR, the biggest share of non-local capital participation is by Americans and the Chinese. Okay, now you're seeing the politics also, and why the current government is also wooing certain countries. Okay, anyways, in Visayas, local share of capital averages to about 90%, with Taiwanese and Japanese having the largest share of capital participation, while in Mindanao, practically all firms are locally owned. Very big share, 97%. Okay. As far as markets, about 3/5 of the firms have local markets, 1/3 have national markets, and nearly 1 in 20 have markets in other ASEAN countries. 3 in 20 have markets in countries outside ASEAN. firms in Mindanao tend to cater less to international markets than those in Visayas and Luzon. And firms in NCR have less local markets but more national markets than the ones in Balanced Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. I always call it Balanced Luzon. No? It's Luzon outside the NCR. No? It's the usual term sometimes that some firms, some NGOs use when they're doing their own surveys. Franchising is rare, with only 2% of firms being franchises. The rate roughly similar across areas. Franchises tend to be concentrated in the food manufacturing industry, which has about 4/5 of all the franchises, and of which 71% and 28% are respectively micro and small establishments. On the aggregate, there seems to be some gender balance in employment, with a female share nearly half. But when you start disaggregating data, we find that the percentage of women among employees ranges to about 40% in Mindanao to 52% in Balanced Luzon. And we also find significant variations in labor share of women across size of the establishment and major industry. Among BPOs, 55% of total employees are female, with micro and medium-sized BPO firms having a female share of more than 70%, while small and medium-sized BPOs having women occupying about 60% of their workforce. Establishments engaged in food manufacturing employ substantially fewer females than male. In other manufacturing, large establishments engaged have about 3/5 of females among their total employment, but SMEs only employ about 1/3 of women in their workforce in other manufacturing. ICT firms have their female shares of total employment at around 2/5, about 40%. As regards human capital, about 3/5 or 57.5% of establishments have no employees with post-baccalaureate degrees. So how can you expect people to innovate if the human capital is the share of firms going from a low of 25.2% among large establishments to as high as 63.2% among micro firms, micro-sized firms that have no employees with post-baccalaureate degrees. And so that alone will tell you that the large firms will be the ones that are more likely to innovate, and you'll see that later. Earlier we pointed out that we adopted this broader view of innovation as accumulation of knowledge and implementation of new ideas. So implementation, so when we operationalize what we mean by innovation, we say a firm innovates if it's a product innovator. In other words, it has a new or significantly improved product or process, or a process innovator, or it is or also aside from, or it has spent on some innovation activity, or it has engaged in some abandoned or ongoing innovation projects. Now, of course, we might know that this is purely technological innovation, so we might want to also ask a few other questions on wider forms of innovation, such as or maybe if the firm has new organizational methods in business practices or external relations. So following the OECD measurement of innovation in the Frascati manual, we adopt, as I said, an operational definition of a firm that is to be innovation active if it's either a product innovator, a process innovator, or if it spent something for innovation activities, or if it engaged in abandoned or ongoing innovation projects. But if we look at this definition, we might have some observations. Firstly, an innovation must be novel or a significant improvement to the firm and possibly to the market or other higher levels. It need not really be new. No? But the fact is, if it gives bigger value, no, somehow. And it must be implemented, in other words, introduced inside the firm or commercialized. So there's no requirement for the innovation to be successful, even. Secondly, the definition of innovation activity does not mention the intention or the objective, although implicitly, innovation aims at improving the firm's competitive position and is associated with some uncertainty about the future. Thirdly, there's no reference to, in the broad definition, to technology. You don't really say specifically technology, but you might get a sense that these new products and processes will probably be technological. So that's why we also ask questions pertaining to organizational and marketing innovation. Now, and in the 2015 SIA, SIA, or other similar surveys that measure innovation, we asked, as I said, wider or non-technological forms of innovation. And now to the main results. Surprise, surprise, not everybody's innovating. two-thirds of firms are innovation active. 30% are product innovators, and about 30% are also process innovators. We find consistently a bigger share of large firms innovating. 40% are product innovators among large firms, whereas among MSMEs, around 30% are product innovations. Regarding being innovation active, among large firms, about two-thirds, 63%, are innovation active compared to only a third among micro-sized firms, 33.9%, or about half for small firms, 49.6%, and for medium firms, 46%. So we already see the pictures that innovation varies by size of firm, but also we are seeing that innovation is varying by industries and by location. Across industries, while about half of firms in manufacturing of goods and services other than food, as well as those in ICT are innovation active, only a third in food manufacturing and BPOs are innovation active. So BPOs are not innovators as much as the other industries. Location-wise, about half in Mindanao and in CR are reporting to be innovation active. They report to be innovation active. Whether or not they really are innovators is another thing altogether. Anyways, while in Visayas and Balance Luzon, the rate of innovation activity is supposed to be slightly less, 37% and 39% respectively. By sector, we are, as already mentioned, as is to be expected, ICT firms are leading in product innovation, with nearly 40% of them being product innovators, while in the BPO sector, only 10% are product innovators. Process innovation-wise, firms in other manufacturing have the highest innovation rate, 37%, while one-fourth in food manufacturing and ICT and one-tenth of BPO firms are process innovators. So these aggregate key statistics on innovation that I just showed you are, especially on product innovation, actually don't differ much from results of other surveys in the Philippines that have so far tried to measure innovation, especially our pilot 2009 SIA, as well as the World Bank's own enterprise survey, which was conducted more or less at the same period, despite a difference in their sampling designs. So we're seeing about a third of firms are product innovators. However, the process innovation rate and the proportion of firms that spend on innovation and R&D appear to be somewhat smaller in our PIDS CIA than the corresponding proportions in the World Bank's enterprise survey. Also, we might note that spending-wise, a quarter of firms had some innovation-related expenditure. Large firms are spending the most, as is to be expected, spending 30 million pesos on average in 1 year. But that is 10 times the average spending of all firms, 3 million pesos. Then across sectors, BPOs are spending the most. Even if the rate is low, they're spending the most. followed by other manufacturing at 4 million, ICT at also 4 million, and food manufacturing at 900,000 pesos. ICT sector spends the highest on innovation, however, relative to gross sales, at about 15.6% compared to that of BPOs, which is they're spending only 2.7% of their value added, their gross sales. Luzon firms are spending about 4 million pesos, closely followed by NCR. And this is twice what firms in Visayas spend, at around 2 million, while Mindanao spends only about half of a million pesos. Okay. Where do they spend on? The most commonly reported activities where investments are made are on, surprise, surprise, internal or external training for the development and or introduction of new products or processes, followed by acquisition of machinery, equipment, or software. Both of these activities are undertaken by more than half of the innovative firms. Next to this spending on innovation was the expenditure on R&D. Half of large firms, in fact, undertook in-house R&D. Now, as far as non-technological or wider forms of innovation that may be conducted in conjunction with product or process innovation or as an independent mechanism for improving competitiveness and productivity of the firm, 3 in 8 on average are engaged in organizational innovation. Among large firms, about half are engaged in organizational changes compared to about 37% for MSMEs. Across major industry, ICT has the highest rate of organizational innovation. As regards marketing innovation, about 40% are marketing innovators. About the same proportion have knowledge management practices. In 2015, a third of innovative active firms filed for intellectual property rights, so IPRs, especially in claiming a brand name or registering a trademark. The filing of IPRs is 5 to more than 20 times higher among innovative active establishments than among firms that did not innovate, depending on the sector. For the 2015 SIA, we also asked firms, this is new, we did not ask this in the pilot 2009 survey, we asked firm questions related to government procurement. About one-fifth, 17% of firms undertook innovation as part of a procurement contract to provide goods and services to a public sector organization, of which a third did so because it was required from the contract. Among BPO firms, as much as a quarter engaged in innovation as part of a government contract, but the bulk of the activities was not required from the contract. I'm wondering why, no? We should be requiring people to mainstream innovation. But then, contracts are not saying this, unfortunately. Anyways, although the information presented so far on innovation activities across firms, including the various visualizations and dashboards or cross-tabulations that I'm showing you, have already suggested to us some factors that influence innovative behavior among firms, they don't explain the effects of these factors in the presence of other factors. So for this purpose, we need to really make use of a cross-section econometric model, particularly a logistic regression, which we did here, to identify the determinants of innovation in Philippine business and industry. So we try to examine certain variables, target variables that might help us explain how likely firms are product innovators, process innovators, organizational innovators, marketing innovators, or technological innovators in general. So we looked at gross sales, age of firm, share of employees with a post-baccalaureate degree, export orientation, in particular whether or not the firm has a geographic market in ASEAN or other countries, foreign ownership, interaction of export orientation and foreign ownership, share of female employment, location, in particular whether the firm is located in NCR, Balas, Luzon, Visayas, or Mindanao, major industry, whether the firm is in food manufacturing, electronics manufacturing, or ICT, compared with BPOs, and engagement in knowledge management practices. So our results, let me just summarize, you're seeing the pluses with to suggest whether it's a positive and whether it's significant or not, but let me just give you the summary of the results. The results suggest that first, knowledge management practice is a good determinant of product innovation, process innovation, and being an innovator. Second, human resources matter. Firms with no employees with post-baccalaureate degrees are likely to be innovators. Gross sales also matters. Firms that are spending more, that have higher gross sales, which typically also means a larger number of employees, we are more likely to innovate than those with lower gross sales, all other things being equal. Location generally does not matter much except for product innovation. Firms in NCR and Balanced Luzon, all other things being equal, are more likely to be product innovators than those in Mindanao and other areas. There are a couple of other things I wanted to say, but we'll just say this maybe on the slides later. Now, of these 891 establishments that were surveyed, we were targeting 1,000 for the 2015 SIA. 232 firms turned out to also have been part of the 2009 pilot. And so we tried to look into their behavior before and their behavior in the 2015 survey. So whether they are, was there a reduction in innovative behavior? And it turns out that maybe you're already seeing that it appears that at least for the panel data, they have less innovation now. And I'm wondering why. You should be innovating more than, but anyways, the panel firms appear to have had changes in their characteristics, partly employment size. While 25 out of the 232 MSMEs had observable upward movements in employment size, 15 MSMEs and 16 large firms had significant downward movements in their number of employees in the past 2 years. So that's partly why it's not surprising why innovation activity may have reduced. I mean, if you have very little deep staff to help you innovate, then naturally that's what you will already expect. Also, we noticed that across all industries, innovation declined except in food manufacturing, where there was an increase in the proportion of establishments, 7.7 percentage points, that had engaged in product innovation, and in ICT, where there was no change. However, surprise, surprise, in BPOs, peers, they're really not innovating, they're innovating less. Now that's a bit worrisome because BPOs are already at risk from Trump, having a first America, an America first policy. And then now we also know that with all of the innovation, the automation happening, there is also at risk. So all the more reason for them to innovate. But they're not. So it's a little bit of something to think about. We further looked into, again, another regression, this time purely for the panel data. And again, when we were looking at these firms, again, to explain not just innovative behavior, but even the reduction possibly of innovative behavior. So we saw, in particular, that age, maybe I can give again the main result. Size is a significant determinant of innovation, particularly for the panel data, no? For process innovation. Then among the panel firms, those engaged in food manufacturing were also more likely to be innovative, active product innovators or process innovators relative to BPOs, all things being equal. The area where the firms are located, particularly whether or not the firm is in an export processing zone, was also found to be marginally significant, at least in explaining marketing innovation behavior. And finally, just as in the cross-section results, we are seeing that knowledge management practice is a good determinant of innovative behavior for the panel firms. Now, in the 2015 SIA, just as in the pilot SIA, the firms were asked what are their perceived effects of innovation. They were asked to rank a number of likely effects on a scale from not relevant to low, medium, or high perceived effects. And the results have varied across industry and size of firms. But generally, however, we would pick up that establishments are reporting the main effects of innovation to be mainly customer-driven. Product-oriented effects are more often highly rated by firms that, than process-related effects. Let's go to the next slide. Introducing innovation also in a firm can be quite complex and requires coordination of multiple inputs, so it's important to gain technical advice from various sources of information, including from internal sources or within the firm itself, or from other establishments within the enterprise, or external, from the market, from institutions such as academia and government, or other sources. However, it appears most firms are reporting internal sources and market sources, especially their clients and competitors, as their most important sources of information and innovation. A third of firms and a fifth of large firms respectively rated internal sources and customers as highly important for innovation, while among SMEs, a tenth and about 14% were saying government's important. Government is not important. That's still the internal sources. Regarding government, practically only 2%, 1.2% are considered to be important, no? For government and public research institutes. So it appears there's very little that they claim to be picking up from government and research institutions, and for that matter, even from academia. Again, which is a bit of another concern. Nearly half of innovative firms are engaged in cooperation with other establishments. There's some cooperation happening. The proportion of innovators across industries ranging with cooperation agreements ranges from about 41% in food manufacturing to about 67% in BPOs. But innovation cooperation appears to be higher among innovation active MSMEs than the corresponding large firms. It appears large firms do not want to cooperate. They're afraid of cooperating. Right. Now, the overall picture is that knowledge networks are also largely limited, with firms tending to cooperate with establishments within their enterprise and with their customers and suppliers. Establishments, especially small, medium, and large firms, do not access technical assistance and support from government and research institutions, and the linkages with firms with academic and research institutions is very low. In 2015, about 3 in 20 firms had some abandoned or delayed innovation projects, especially among large firms. Serious delays were also reported by a third of large firms in ICT compared to 3 out of 20 large firms in food manufacturing and in other manufacturing. firms are reporting also cost factors as the most important barriers to innovation, particularly for large innovative establishments. Knowledge factors such as lack of qualified personnel and difficulty in finding cooperation partners also appear to be a hindrance in innovative behavior. For MSMEs, another concern for them is that the market is being dominated by established enterprises, thus suggesting the importance of a competitive environment for innovation, which we do not have, at least not at the moment, according to MSMEs. All right. Of course, while rarely did firms avail of public financial support for innovation, the only 3.1% overall of firms said they are getting some support from government. And the proportion is highest among large firms in the BPO sector. However, for MSMEs and large firms across industries, the proportion receiving government assistance is actually, when you ask them what specific, you might be getting some kind of financial support, when you tell them maybe you're getting this, this, and that, the figure becomes higher, it becomes 7.2%, double. Overall, a firm, you know, I guess people forget that incentives, you know, financial incentives are also support. A fifth of firms, were aware of some policies, initiatives by government, so about 18.5%, of which nearly half said they were getting some government support or assistance, income tax holidays, particularly by large firms in BPOs. Others very well availed of tax-related incentives such as tax deductions, duty-free exemption, duty-free importation, tax deduction, VAT exemptions and credits. In 2015, all financial incentives were roughly availed of by about 6 to 7% of firms, especially MSMEs. MSMEs tended to consider, however, the training. I need the right slide.
This is 41.
MSMEs tended to consider training, tax deductions, tax holidays, tax credits, and loans to be very important government programs, while large firms also value training, tax holidays, tax deductions, duty-free importation, and tax credits. But on average, government support programs least cited to be highly important include R&D funding, because they probably need a big amount and we're not giving it to them, and direct subsidies. Okay, as of 2015, a third of these firms were registered either with BOI, PEZA, or some other investment promotion. Okay, I guess people can still hear me. But anyways. Okay. So, about a third of firms... Okay, a third of firms are registered, no, with some IPA. A quarter of MSMEs registered at either BOI, a PESA, or both, while among large firms, 70.5% are registered with PESA, 9.2% with BOI, and 3.4% with both. But that was when Dilima was still the not the one in jail, no? Okay, anyways. We also asked firms specific suggestions. This is also something new. What do you think government should do to help you, no, to innovate, to foster innovation? 40%, surprise, surprise, did not give specific suggestions. But most firms, whether MSMEs or large firms. Most firms, whether MSMEs or large firms, identified capacity building to be a mechanism for encouraging innovation. For MSMEs and large firms, the suggestion that ranked next to capacity building was financial support and ease of doing business, respectively, which reminds me even my friend who is part owner of a restaurant said, nakakainis ang gobyerno, bakit ba ganyan? Magkasarado ka na ng kasi they were closing their restaurant in Taguig. Sasarado ka na, ang dami pang ipapagawa sa'yo. It's even harder than starting a business. And then you have to pay all sorts of things extra. Hindi ka lang ako makikita eh. Sabi niya, ano ba yan? Gobyerno ka ba talaga? Tinatang sa akin sabi ko, hindi, ano kami, POCC kami ha. So anyways, really, I mean, I feel for firms when people always talk about how ease of doing business is really, really, really having, it's not easy at all. Alright, fostering innovation in Philippine industry is of course a big challenge given the many constraints that we work with. Scarce resources, including requisite number of research scientists and engineers. No, we have very few. Then you have competing interests of public policy as well as institutional issues. Given the key findings of the survey, we of course would like to highlight some policy issues. Firstly, we should all realize the importance of human capacity issues, whether in firms or in government. Innovation is after all about accumulating knowledge capital that enters firms and not in the public sector or the national production function along with physical and human capital. R&D spending will have little impact without a vast pool of well-trained engineers and scientists and human resources. One of the reasons why China is where it is today, believe it or not, can be attributed to something they did in 1970s. You know what they did when they opened up? They sent so many people. But there was a story about this. Former President Jimmy Carter that's why they loved him so much in China. He sent his national science advisor, a geologist, Dr. Frank Press, to China to meet Deng Xiaoping before they started, you know, the formal opening of China to the world. Deng really wanted the science advisor. Of course, this guy, Frank Press, when he was brought to China, when he was first called to the White House, he was told by Jimmy Carter that you are being asked by the main guy in China. Why? He was wondering what's happening. So Dr. Press, when he went to China, he finally understood. They were trying to ask the U.S. to support China by giving 5,000 slots in the best universities in the U.S. 5,000 slots. So, of course, this guy said, I'm not a politician. I cannot promise this thing. So I have to first go back to the U.S. and talk with the president. I hope you won't mind, etc. But anyways, to cut the long story short, he got the approval of the government for the 5,000 slots for the Chinese. So he went back to Mr. Deng, and then Deng said, "Can you call Mr. Carter?" "Oh, yeah, sir, it's 3 a.m. in the morning in Washington, D.C. I cannot just wake him up. It might be difficult to do that. You need to talk with Carter and tell him I want more." Okay. Of course, now this, let me show you this is something that Jimmy Carter wrote. Let me quote that. "One breakthrough or cultural exchanges that we made, you might say, is in the middle of the night. As president, a president, when he is sleeping in the White House, is rarely disturbed unless there is some crisis that arises, something that he needs to address that won't wait until morning. One night, Rosalyn and I were sleeping in the bedroom and the phone rang about 3 o'clock in the morning and I thought, oh my, there's a tragedy somewhere in the United States. I woke up and answered the phone. It was my national science advisor, who was Dr. Frank Press, a geologist. I said, 'Frank, what's happened? Another Mount Etna or something like that exploded? He said, no, I'm in China with Deng Xiaoping. And I said, what has happened with Deng Xiaoping? What's wrong? And he said, Deng Xiaoping insisted I call to see if you would permit 5,000 Chinese students to come to American universities. And I was very angry. I said, tell him to send 100,000. And I slammed the phone down. I continue. Within 5 years, we had 100,000 Chinese students with us. And by the way, when you start reading this thing, this was started off by US as a token to China, but then the Chinese also invested in their people. Now, let me ask you, how many actually have been sent by government to study abroad? You still want your exception because that was the grips, no? But that was the exception. Money, even for your tuition? Hindi naman siguro, no? Oh, no. But tuition, money, everything. I know Malaysia sends people to Cambridge. Thailand does it. Tayo, ilan, in the past 50 years, how many people have we sent? Zero. I remember I had a talk before with the late Don Padiranga was saying, this is something that needs to be changed. Seriously. Because even now, ang may nantay natin, laging crumbs ng mga scholarship grants from Japan, from U.S. Fulbright. Diba? Wala eh. Wala na tayo ginagastos eh. EU scholarships. But all these scholarships are just crumbs because alam mo na ngayon nila, syempre yung mga other countries kasi sobra na yung binibigay sa atin. No? Crumbs na lang binibigay kung mayroon na matira. So, we need to change. That's where we should be changing. Now, of course, a better understanding of linkages also between skills and innovation is needed. There's danger in having more investments but not well thought of ones. Having more training. Sige, lagi more training, more funds for free college education. That's a favorite here at PIDS because you're so against it. But while higher levels of human capital are needed, simple, more is better prescriptions may not necessarily achieve desired outcomes. Now, the 2015 SIA shows that large establishments are certainly more likely to engage in innovation, especially as they're in a much better financial capacity. Also, there are various bottlenecks faced by MSMEs to innovate, constraints for accessing finance, knowledge, and skills by MSMEs are not similar to those faced by large firms who can probably get better people and access also finance. But one must be cautious that merely supporting MSMEs just for the sake of supporting them without any focus can be a recipe for disaster. MSMEs need to be supported but with the aim of using innovation to help them develop eventually into large-sized, more productive firms. Strengthening linkages between knowledge producers and users certainly is important given the shift towards a more open system of innovation and the importance of knowledge management practices. Government needs to be proactive in promoting free exchange of knowledge and ideas and flow of knowledge from outside companies. But unfortunately, large firms tend to be very cautious about cooperation. These large firms need to be stimulated to cooperate rather than being averse to networking with competitors. I mean, it's pretty obvious. For instance, even if you ask somebody to a telco, can you help us? Okay, let's have a cooperation. They will agree the other one is not there. No?
If the other one is
not. They're always so afraid. Then actually, so irritating. Okay. Anyways, improving networking linkages and collaboration between the government, among government industry associations, and universities and research institutions must be pursued vigorously with far better budgets than what we currently have available. The apparent decline in innovation, particularly in the BPO sector from the panel data, should be a cause for concern, especially as I mentioned because of Trump's America's First policy, but also from the risk of automation and the fourth industrial revolution, no? That's already happening. The IT BPM sector is one of the pillars of the economy, dominates services, exports, and establishes significant spillover benefits to other industries. And as articulated in the Comprehensive National Industry Strategy and Philippine Development Plan, as well as the industry's own roadmap, Roadmap 2022, Accelerate Philippines, the country must continue to expand the market share of the IT BPM sector while moving up the global value chain to more complex and higher value services. What this means, you have to ask Monet, no? She was done about this. Okay, she's the services lady. Okay. As far as harnessing government procurement as a catalyst for innovation, given the volume now and range of public sector needs, as well as a current initiative to right-size government, the potential for of government procurement as a tool to spur innovation should not be ignored. Certainly, we need to understand the risk and learning from successful examples of innovation through government procurement, both here and in other countries. Regarding regulatory frameworks, government must also start to look into our regulatory environment. Dr. Yang, in fact, has an entire set of papers about the regulation. No? We need to keep examining our regulatory framework. Because sometimes regulators tend to have a focus on implementing the rules, not exactly recognizing that there are changing environments.